Before we get into the lesson, I want to remind everybody again about building healthy marriages. Really would love to have a lot of couples sign up for this. It's going to be on Monday nights. It starts on September 13th. We're going to run from 6:30 to 8, and it's impossible to find a right time to do this, by the way. That's either too early or too late for a lot of people. But if you can at all make it for that, Dr. Bob Whitten is very knowledgeable about this subject. He has done marriage seminars for years and years. He's written a book, and I'm reading his book currently. It is good. Everybody that signs up is going to receive a book and also a workbook that we will be going through. And so really encourage you. It doesn't matter how long you've been married. There's always things that you can learn about having a greater marriage. I mean, who couldn't use better communication in a relationship? Who couldn't use a better way of resolving conflicts whenever you have a disagreement between the two of you? So there's always more to learn, and so I want to encourage you to do that. If you will open your Bible to the book of Galatians and get the notes out of the bulletin, we're going to be talking about Galatians. We're working through the plain gospel and what we're supposed to do with it. We're trying not to add anything to it. We just want to present just the plain gospel. And then we're going to talk about what to do with it. Of course, I think Chase kind of covered a little bit of what to do with it this morning. Did you catch that? I think he was pretty clear about what we're supposed to do with the gospel. We're supposed to be out sharing it with others. And so that's just one of the things that we're supposed to be doing with it. This is a study that I hope is going to just pique your interest, that you're going to want to know more and more about the gospel. I can tell you, over the last few months, I have very much enjoyed getting a clearer picture in my mind of just what the Bible says. We know what man says. We hear that a lot. What does the Bible say? And when we get back to the unadulterated, the unchanged gospel, the plain gospel, and really see what it's like, it is amazing how powerful and how wonderful the gospel is. So talk about Galatians here. When the gospel is not the gospel. We're going to see that in the book of Galatians today. What is it about the gospel that makes it not the gospel? When does that happen? We're going to see that. In fact, we're going to get into that right away. The first point is deserting the gospel. And under that, number one, how sad that the Galatians were already turning to a different gospel after a very short time. Look at Galatians chapter 1, starting in verse 6. I am amazed that you're so quickly deserting him who called you by the grace of Christ for a different gospel, which is really not another. Only there are some who are disturbing you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to what we have preached to you, he is to be accursed. Paul says, I'm amazed, I'm astonished, one translation says. I can't believe this is happening, that in such a short time, Paul had gone and he had preached in the region of Galatia, and Galatia is not a single church. It is several churches, Antioch, Iconium, Lystra, Derbe, all those are in the region of Galatia. You've got a map in the back of your Bible. You can find those. And he's writing to all those churches because, as a whole, they are departing away from the gospel that he had just taught them. And he's disappointed. Have you ever been disappointed by somebody and what they do? I think there are realistic disappointments and there are unrealistic disappointments. Sometimes we set ourselves up for unrealistic disappointments. We've decided if I do this, the other person's going to do that, and this is exactly the way it's going to go, and then it doesn't go that way, and you're disappointed, right? I've tried to stop myself from doing that. I found that bugs me, and I've tried to not do that. Because you can't always count on people to do the right thing, to say the right thing. But there are realistic expectations of people. And it's not unrealistic for Paul to expect the churches in Galatia to adhere to the gospel which he had just taught to them. Not long before this. That's not unrealistic. Just like it's not unrealistic for Christ to expect the Shekoda Church of Christ to adhere firmly to the gospel. That's not unrealistic for our Lord to expect that from you and I, is it? So there's realistic and then there's unrealistic expectations. Paul was amazed. He says, I'm blown away. I just can't believe this is happening. You're deserting him who called you for another gospel. Number two, preaching a different gospel is the same as deserting Christ. That's what he says. I'm amazed that you're so quickly deserting him who called you by the grace of Christ for a different gospel. Now, after studying this verse, you may come to the conclusion that that's not actually Christ, that's actually God, and I won't argue with you a lot about it, because on one hand, you're deserting Christ, and on the other hand, you're deserting God the Father, which is good. Neither of those is good. So you read that whichever way you want, neither is a good position to be in. When we change, when we depart from the gospel, we're deserting Christ. The people who used to adhere to the gospel that you know and that I know, and they have departed, they've gone on to something different. They didn't just desert us. They didn't just desert the church. They deserted Christ. That's what the Bible says. They have turned away from him. Now, they will, of course, deny that, I'm sure. But that's what Paul is saying. He says, I can't believe you turned to a different gospel. You are deserting your Lord. You're turning away from him. Number three, a distorted gospel is not even a gospel. Back again to my title, when the gospel is not the gospel. It sounds almost like a riddle, doesn't it? When is the gospel not the gospel? Well, it's not the gospel when we change it. As long as we preach it and follow it the way the Bible says, it's the gospel. But if you change it, it's not the gospel anymore. Imagine that you are a person who has heard a variation of the gospel of the Bible. Now, let's just assume that you really believe that that was accurate. Some pastor or a religious leader just told you that, and that's what you did. And you honestly believed that your sins were all forgiven and that you were right with God. But then you got to judgment day and you found out you weren't right with God. Now tell me that's good news. You see, when the gospel is not the gospel, when we alter it, it's not good news anymore. It's bad news. It's frightening that people alter and change the gospel. I mean, we got to get serious about this. People don't realize the damage they're doing by saying, well, I'm just going to change this. I'm just going to adapt it a little bit. I kind of like it more this way. You and I don't have the right to do that. When we change the gospel, it's not gospel anymore. It's no longer good news. It is bad news. We can't do that. Number four, a tainted gospel is disturbing. It is even destructive to those who listen. Look again at verse 7, which is really not another, only there are some who are disturbing you. They want to distort the gospel of Christ. It is disturbing. It is troubling when people change the gospel. It is even spiritually destructive to those who listen. On judgment day, who is going to be accountable for the wrong that's been taught? Is it the one that teaches it or the ones who listen and believe it? Both. Both are going to be accountable. Certainly, the person that says something that is wrong, that is contrary to the Word of God, they're going to stand before God and they're going to give an account for every careless word that came out of their mouth. But the person who sits there and listens and never bothers to challenge that and say, is that really in the Bible? What about this verse over here? The one who just gullibly accepts that will also be accountable on the day of judgment because they did not take the time, the care, to make sure that what they were being taught was taught accurately. We are all responsible for making sure God's word is taught accurately. Which leads us to our second point here, B. Let's talk about the curse of man-made gospels. Number one, there is a curse on anyone who alters the plain gospel. Now, I want to back up and read verse 8 again because it runs into verse 9, and we'll read 8 through 10 together. But even if we, and Paul means himself and those who were teaching with him, even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to what we have preached to you, he is to be accursed. As we have said before, so I say again now, if any man is preaching to you a gospel contrary to what you received, he is to be accursed. For am I now seeking the favor of men or of God? Or am I striving to please men? If I were still trying to please men, I would not be a bond servant of Christ. Paul is anticipating what excuses they might give for changing the gospel. Well, so-and-so came along, and they're pretty well respected. Rabbi so-and-so came along, and you know, they're really well known, and they said it's this way. Paul says, I don't care who it was. I don't care if it was an angel from heaven. I love that. Couldn't you just see some? Well, an angel from heaven came down and says, I don't care if it was an angel from heaven. If it's a different gospel, it's false. I don't care who says it. I don't care how many degrees behind their name. I don't care how popular they are or how big their TV program is. I just don't care. If it's a different gospel, it's a different gospel, and don't listen to it. It doesn't matter what the source is. It says if it varies from what we taught you, it's wrong. If it varies from the standard of the Word of God, it is wrong. And the person that teaches it is accursed. That's what he says. That's pretty plain, isn't it? When we vary from the gospel, we teach something which we will be cursed for. How would you like to be cursed by God? I wouldn't want to be in that position. We need to adhere firmly to the Word of God. What would ever cause you or I to vary from the pattern of the Word of God? I mean, we sit here, talk about it, and it just seems like so simple. And yet, I know people who used to sit where you're sitting, and today, they're not following the gospel. I'm sad to say that. What is it that changes us? Well, I think Paul hits on something here that's pretty common. There in that last verse, verse 10. For am I seeking the favor of men or of God? You know, point two, when pleasing man becomes more important than pleasing God, the plain gospel gets distorted. When it means more to you to please people than it does to please Almighty God, you're in trouble. That's when you're going to get dissuaded from following the Word of God. That's when somebody can step in and say, well, you know what? You're being pretty radical with this stuff. Why don't you just pipe down on some of that? That's not God talking, that's man. We can change this up a little bit. It's not going to hurt anything. That's not the message of God. That is man talking. And when it's more important to you to please people than it is to please God, then you're in trouble. In our study of the book of James that Roy is doing, he's going to get to chapter 4 one day. I have more confidence than Nolan does, right? He's going to get there, all right? And when he gets to chapter 4 and verse 4, you know what he says there? He says, you adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is hostility toward God. It means more to you to be a friend with the world. I just want to get along with everybody. And I understand the mindset there. I like getting along with everybody too. I'm with you there. It boils down to a choice between pleasing this world and pleasing my God. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to please God. And if y'all aren't pleased with it, I'm sorry. Okay? But I'm going to please God. Because friendship with the world is hostility toward God. And I don't want God as my enemy. How about you? Let's stop trying to please the world. You can't please the world anyway if you haven't figured that out. There's no way. No, I don't care what you do, they're not going to be pleased. If this group likes what you do, that group won't. You can't please men, but you can please God. Isn't that incredible? You can please Almighty God. He says what to do. We just do it. That's it. God's happy. We can do that. I can't please people. So I'm going to please God. This is what pushes people away. Wanting the favor of men over the favor of God. You know, the most popular doctrine is not necessarily the most correct doctrine. Quite often it's not. Just because it's the popular one, this is what everybody's teaching, doesn't mean it's the right one. That's why we have to check it. You know, Paul says, am I striving to please men? If I were still trying to please men, I would not be a bond servant of Christ. I know that's why Chase led that song for us about pierce my ear, O Lord. You can just see that slave appealing to the elders at the gate. I love my master. I want to be a slave permanently. Not just till the next year of Jubilee. I want to forever serve my master. That's what a bond servant was. That's what I want to do. I want to be a bond servant. I want to please him all the time. I'm not into pleasing people. I want to please God. And it takes that kind of tenacity to stick with the gospel. The reason there are so many people teaching so many different wild things contrary to the word of God is because people are not bondservants of Christ. And if you allow yourself to be compromised in your teaching of the word of God, you are not a bondservant of Christ. That's not me. That's the word of God. That's what it says. Number three, any gospel that comes from a man is not the true gospel. Look at verse 11 with me. For I would have you know, brethren, that the gospel which was preached by me is not according to man. For I neither received it from man, nor was I taught it, but I received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ. Now, Paul has been on this rant since verse 1. You know, back up and look at verse 1, how he opens the letter. Paul, an apostle, not from men, nor through the agency of man, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead. He says, the things I'm teaching, this isn't from people. I didn't get it from people. I got it from Jesus. I got it directly. And that's where you and I need to get our gospel. We need to get directly from the Word of God, directly here. He says in verse 11, I would have you know, brethren, that the gospel which was preached was not according to man. If the things that you believe and teach and preach to others, if it is man-made, it is wrong. And I'm not trying to be gender exclusive here, man or woman. I don't care who taught it to you, man or woman. If it's from a human being, it's false. It needs to come directly from God. That's the only way to get it right. So let's look at, in the time we have left, God's, or the gospel's original intention. See, what is the original intention? What was it created for? this is where, boy, a lot of digging has opened my eyes to how far this gospel really goes. First of all, number one, the truth of the gospel must always remain with the church. That's what he says in chapter 2. And look at verse 4. It was because of the false brethren secretly brought in, who had sneaked in to spy on our liberty, which we have in Christ Jesus, in order to bring us into bondage. And he's talking here, if you don't know, about Judaizers. The Judaizers were the ones who were following Paul around, and anytime Paul would leave a town, they would come in behind him and say, now Paul taught you some good things. Do a lot of those things, but you also need to be circumcised. And you also need to keep the law, so make sure you do that too. And they were pulling into bondage some people that Christ had just set free, trying to keep these laws that nobody could keep. And he's saying they're spying on our freedom that we have in Christ, and they're trying to make us slaves, bring us into bondage. Verse 5, but we did not yield in subjection to them for even an hour, so that the truth of the gospel would remain with you. Did you catch that? That the truth of the gospel would remain with you, meaning with the church. But from those who were of high reputation, and what they were makes no difference to me. God shows no partiality. Paul said, I don't care who they are. Well, those who were of reputation contributed nothing to me. But on the contrary, seeing that I have been entrusted with the gospel to the circumcised, just as Peter had been to the uncircumcised. This gospel, this truth, is to remain with the church. When people seek the gospel, they need to come here. They need to know that here is a place where we preach the gospel, the plain gospel. We don't add anything to it. We only follow what the Bible says. The plain gospel is something that we are entrusted with as stewards. Notice he says in verse 7, it has been entrusted to him. Entrusted means that we are stewards. A steward means the gospel is not something that we own. It's not ours to do with what we want. This is God's, and we're just entrusted with it as stewards of it. We're to take care of the gospel. And Paul says, that's how I am. I was entrusted with sharing the gospel with the uncircumcised, with the Gentiles, just like Peter was to the circumcised. And that was interesting to me, because did Peter ever preach to Gentiles? Read Acts 10. He sure did, didn't he? Now, it was reluctant. I mean, Jesus had to come to him and give him a little lesson on what's clean and what's unclean, but he went and preached to the Gentiles, even though he was the apostle to the Jews. So just because you may think there's a certain group that you're supposed to reach, don't be surprised if God doesn't send you to somebody else that's outside your realm of comfort. Maybe somebody that's not in your age bracket, or your social status, or your racial background. They may send you to somebody that you didn't expect. You preach the gospel wherever Jesus sends you, and share it with whomever he sends you to. Peter was the apostle to the circumcised, but he shared the gospel with Cornelius and his household. Number two, it is because of the gospel that we're expected to treat brethren like brethren. Now here's one of those that you got to dig a little bit, but listen carefully to what happens next here in verse 11. But when Cephas, and Cephas is Peter, just so you know, but when Peter came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face, because he stood condemned. For prior to the coming of certain men from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. But when they came, he began to withdraw and hold himself aloof. Look at this. Fearing the party of the circumcision. It's always fear, isn't it? The rest of the Jews joined him in hypocrisy, and as a result, even Barnabas was carried away by their hypocrisy. But when I saw that they were not straightforward about the truth of the gospel. I'm going to read that again. They were not straightforward about the truth of the gospel. I oppose Cephas, Peter, in the presence of all. If you, being a Jew, live like the Gentiles and not like the Jews, how is it that you compel the Gentiles to live like Jews? This gospel, the more I study it, it's like a vein of gold in a mountain. And the more you dig, you start realizing that vein runs pretty deep. And you just keep finding these nuggets. And I had no idea when I started this study that the gospel has a bearing on the way you and I treat each other. But when Peter stopped treating his brethren the way he was supposed to, and when Paul confronts him, notice what he tells him. I saw that they were not straightforward about the truth of what? The gospel. You see, when we mistreat each other, when we show favoritism, we're not following the truth of the gospel. That's how far-reaching this gospel is. It even has a bearing on how you and I treat each other. It's deep stuff. I mean, just keep chipping away at this stuff. Keep reading and studying the gospel. It runs deep. And he says, Peter, what in the world are you doing? See, Peter was fine with the Gentiles before. He's hanging out with them. There he's eating with them. He's worshiping with them. And then along come the Jews. He's like, oh man, I better straighten up. And Paul sees it. And Paul confronts him about it. Says, Peter, what are you doing? You trying to act like a good Jew now? You weren't even a good Jew before Jesus, you know? Why are you trying to act like a good Jew now? You're in the wrong, Peter. You're in the wrong, and the way that you are treating your brother, and you're not following the truth of the gospel. Following the truth of the gospel means we treat each other a certain way. And all that is involved in this. All that is a part of this gospel message. Number three, through the scripture, the gospel was preached to Abram. Here's another little nugget. Look at chapter 3 now of Galatians and verse 6. Even so, Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Therefore, be sure that it is those who are of faith who are the sons of Abraham. The scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, he preached the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, all the nations will be blessed in you. And so through the scripture, the gospel had been preached to Abraham. Now, if you don't understand that, and let's just say you're reading through the Bible and you come across this verse and you say, okay, I don't really understand that. You know what our tendency is to reach for that commentary, don't we? And I've studied with people who are more dependent on the commentaries than they are on the Word of God. And so let me show you a better way to say that. First of all, when you go to a commentary, you may be disappointed that it doesn't answer all your questions anyway. You ever had that happen? You look at a commentary, it didn't really deal with what you were wanting. So let me show you a better way, and I'm not against commentaries. Commentaries are wonderful when they have their place, if you've wrestled with the text first, so that when you go to the commentary, it can't mislead you. But let me show you how you wrestle with the text. One of the best things that you can do is read several translations of the same passage. And so I'm going to put some up here, and I just want you to read these along with me. The first one is the American Standard Version. It says, and the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel beforehand unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all the nations be blessed. Now maybe you don't understand, how did the scripture preach the gospel to Abraham long before the new covenant? Maybe that's not You know, and so you read this verse, it's okay, well, the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles. So it's got something to do with the justification of the Gentiles, doesn't it? And we look at this next one, the Bible in basic English says, and the holy writing seeing before the event that God would give Gentiles righteousness by faith, gave the good news before to Abraham, saying, in you all the nations have a blessing. It says he gave this good news somehow before, and who did it? The scripture. He's personifying the scripture, which the Bible does many times. Talks about the scripture speaking. Here the scripture is telling Abraham something. He's telling them something about these Gentiles. When we look at the easy to read version, we see the scriptures told what would happen in the future. These writings said that God would make the non-Jewish people right through their faith. God told his good news to Abraham before it happened. God said to Abraham, I will use you to bless all the peoples on earth. Are the pieces starting to come together here? This verse reminds me of something I knew ahead of time, but it reminded me that a Gentile is a non-Jew. He says he makes the non-Jewish people right. And so you just learn a little bit from each of these translations. Let me put some more up here for you. The contemporary English version says, long ago the scripture said that God would accept the Gentiles because of their faith, and that is why God told Abraham the good news that all nations would be blessed because of him. Notice this one doesn't have any quotes in it. It mentions, that's why God told Abraham the good news. And so he told him something about these Gentiles were going to be saved. This good news. The Christian Standard Bible says, now the scripture saw in advance that God would justify the Gentiles by faith and proclaim the gospel ahead of time to Abraham, saying, all the nations will be blessed through you. He proclaimed the gospel. Notice it says ahead. And then the next verse here, the International Standard Version, or excuse me, the English Standard Version says, and the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith preached the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, in you all the nations shall be blessed. He's actually, there's a word here used in the Greek that is nowhere else in the Bible. It is pro euangelizo amahi. Pro meaning before. Euangelizo is the word for gospel, which I've shared with you before. So before the gospel, beforehand, and these two translations, the Christian Standard Bible and the English Standard Version, really bring this point out. Let me show you some others here. The International Standard Version says, because the scripture saw ahead of time that God would justify Gentiles by faith, it announced the gospel to Abraham beforehand when it said, through you all the nations will be blessed. And then he says in the New Living Translation, what's more, the gospel looked forward to this time when God would make the Gentiles right in his sight because of the faith. God proclaimed this good news to Abraham long ago when he said, all nations will be blessed through you. Notice the emphasis on all. All nations. Would that include Gentiles? And yet this is way, way back before the new covenant. In fact, this is Genesis chapter 12, verse 3. Here's another one. You may have heard of the King James Bible. And the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all the nations be blessed. Again, all nations are going to be blessed. Here he calls them the heathen. The New King James, which is on the next page here, the New King James says, and the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles instead of the heathen, the Gentiles by faith, preach the gospel to Abraham, saying, in you instead of thee, in you all the nations shall be blessed. Here's the New International Reader's Version. This is supposed to be written at like a second grade reading level. That's what I need. How about you? Just put the cookies on a shelf where I can reach them. Long ago, Scripture knew that God would make non-Jews right with himself by believing in him. He announced the good news ahead of time to Abraham. He said, all nations will be blessed because of you. Is this starting to come together? I mean, when you do it this way, and it takes more effort. I'll grant you that. This is a little harder than just reading a commentary and letting somebody tell you what it says. But if you will take the time to look at, and these versions I'm putting up here are not necessarily ones that I care all that much for. They're ones that I wouldn't necessarily recommend. If somebody said what kind of Bible to get, I wouldn't recommend some of these. But they have verses that lend some clarity. It's stating some things a different way. And so when you get to this last one is the NIV 1984 version. Says the scripture foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles by faith and announce the gospel in advance to Abraham. All nations will be blessed through you. So by the time you read all of those, you can see the gospel was announced by scripture to Abraham. Not all the gospel, but a portion of it. When the scriptures told Abraham, through you all nations will be blessed, he was showing him that portion of the gospel that says, you and I can be saved. That's good news, isn't it? That's gospel. Okay? You and I who are not Jews, we have a way to be saved. So just, you know, a little thing on next time you study the Bible, try this. Try several translations. If you don't have a Bible program with all of them, maybe you have several at your house. Look it up in several different versions. It's a good way to find the truth. All right, let me get back here to the last point. Number four, the gospel unites us by clothing us with Christ. At the end of chapter 3, verse 26, it says, for you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For all of you were baptized into Christ, have clothed yourself with Christ. The next verse, verse 28, there is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you knew what it took for an ex-Pharisee to say what he just said, that was so hard for him to say. You know what? A Pharisee would get up every morning. He would thank God that he was a Jew and not a Gentile. He would thank God that he was free and not a slave. And I'm sorry, ladies, he would thank God that he was a man and not a woman. And if you understood the time, you would know why, right? For him to say, it doesn't matter if you're a Jew or Gentile. It doesn't matter if you're a slave or free. It doesn't matter if you're a man or a woman. We are all one in Christ Jesus. Man, that took a lot for him to say those words. What makes us one? The fact that we have been bound together. We have clothed ourselves with Christ. I want you to look close at verse 27. Don't close your Bible yet. We're not done here. Look close at verse 27. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. Now, is he saying that you get clothed with Christ and later you get baptized? Is that what that verse says? No. When you're baptized, that's when you're clothed with Christ. That's what the Bible says. Why does the religious world say you get clothed with Christ? And later, if you want to get baptized, that's a great idea as an outward sign of your inward faith. Where is that verse? That's not what the Bible says. When you're baptized, that is the moment when you are clothed with Christ. And then those who listen to a different gospel, they never obey the gospel. They never obey the gospel. It's being taught here. They're never baptized, which means they are never clothed with Christ, which means they are never united with believers. Isn't that sad? You change the gospel, you alter it, you mess a lot of stuff up. What unites us today, tonight, is we've been baptized into Christ. We have obeyed the gospel. And that gives us a bond. And as I look around this room, I see different ages. I see different backgrounds, social backgrounds. Some of us are even from strange places like Colorado, you know, and places like that, you know. We're different. We're different folks, but we're brought together by one thing. We are clothed with Christ. And that gives us a unity that nobody can take away from us. All that is possible because of the gospel. I'm loving this gospel stuff. How about you? That's pretty good stuff, isn't it? And we just got to chapter 3. I'm not even done. Okay? But we'll save the rest for another time. So much to learn about this gospel. We want to be united. Maybe you're here tonight and you've not been united with Christ in baptism. We'd love to talk to you about that. We'd love to show you what the gospel is and how to obey it. But perhaps you have obeyed the gospel, but you've not been living the way that you know you should. You know, we are created for a purpose. And we want God to create in us a heart of love. We want Him to pierce our ear. We want to become His bondservants. He can make us that way. If you're lacking in any way and you're needing prayers, please come as we stand to sing.